Welcome to the Rabbi Show.
The Rabbi Show.
Now you can connect with your own personal rabbi. Rabbi Yitzwein from the Young Israel Aish of Las Vegas is here at 257 KDWN.
All right, good morning and happy Purim. My name is Yitzwein. I'm the rabbi of Young Israel, Aish of Las Vegas, and your host here on The Rabbi Show. And boy, oh boy, we're having a lot of fun today, because today is Purim. Yay! Very, very big. I just noticed, I just now pulled up my Facebook page, and someone I like very much just liked the Simon, what is this? It's a video. It's a video on my Facebook page. It's Simon on Purim video. It's very funny. Last night, everyone's a little shicker. Okay, not a little shicker, a lot shicker. Everyone's, you know, because on Purim, you gotta drink. So you'll notice if you go on to the Yitzwein, Yitzwyne, Facebook page, it's a nice looking video. I haven't seen it, but I do recall somewhat of what we were speaking about. You will see me dressed as a fireman. The reason I was dressed as a fireman last night, even though I preferred to be dressed as a judge, was because my wife said, if someone calls 911, who comes running? A judge? No, a fireman. So that's who you got to be. Anyway, you'll also notice on Purim, I shave my beard. It's the annual beard shaving event. The reason I do this is that I look innocent and cute. That's the reason, yes. That's why I do it. I do. I also happen to be, today I'm wearing my blue jeans. Now, you'll say, well, what's the big deal? Don't you wear blue jeans all the time? The answer is no, I really don't. As a matter of fact, I probably wear my Levi's 501s once a year on Purim. Maybe twice. Sometimes they sneak on me, you know. I guess it sounds like I don't wash them if they sneak on me, right? No, I wash my blue jeans with Downy every time I wear them, you know, once a year, twice a year, whatever, with detergent and Downy. And I do this. Rabbis don't really wear blue jeans. It's just like, it's not a Jewish law. It's just kind of the way it is. And these are the same jeans I've had since before I moved to Las Vegas, so they got to be at least 23 years old. And yes, they fit perfectly on me. Thank God. Thank God. I'm very happy about that. I take pleasure in that. How many people can say, yes, they fit in their clothes that are 23 years old? 23 years old, blue jeans. Who can say that? Who can say that? All right, the number to call is 702-257-5396. We're going to talk about Purim because there's a lot going on. A lot going on. Now, here's the thing. What is Purim all about? So I ask you this question. Dum, 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 dum. What is a more important holiday, Purim or Yom Kippur? Now, surely everyone knows Yom Kippur. Oh, my gosh. Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement. Everyone knows Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur is mentioned in the Torah. Yom Kippur is the day when Moses came down from Mount Sinai for the second time. Third time, actually. And with the second set of tablets. Remember, Moses goes up the mountain, stays there for 40 days and 40 nights, writes the Ten Commandments on a set of tablets. He comes down. He sees some Jews, not a lot of Jews, but some Jews worshiping the golden calf. And Moses throws down the tablets, smashes them, and then grinds up the calf, punishes the sinners. Only 3,000 people were killed then, by the way. It wasn't like in Cecil B. DeMille's movie when everyone is debauchery and the women are partying on the shoulders of the men worshiping the calf. It wasn't exactly like that. But Moses comes out and he smashes the first set of tablets, and God wants to destroy the Jewish people after the sin of the golden calf. What does Moses do? He goes up the mountain again, pleads to God, and says, God, if you're going to wipe out this nation, then erase my name from your book. Moses is ready to put his life in the line for the sake of the Jewish people. God forgives the Jewish people, and Moses comes down with a second set of tablets, thereby illustrating how the Almighty loves the Jewish people and forgave them. And that is Yom Kippur. Day of Atonement. Big day. Big, big, big. What is a bigger day? What's a more important day? Purim or Yom Kippur? Ha! Well, what happened on Purim? Okay, this is going to get real long. But on Purim, which happened after the Torah was given, about 800 years, more than that, 900 years after the Torah was given. Let's think about this for a second. Yeah, 900 years after the Torah is given. And there was a bad man. His name was Haman. The Jewish people go to a party. They go to a party that the king, I don't even know how to say this in English, Ahasuerus in the Persian Empire. All this is recorded in the book of Esther, by the way. If you want to go, you want the story, just read the book of Esther. It's in the Bible, in what Christians would call the Old Testament. Okay, so anyway, you read the book of Esther, and there's a king. His name is Ahasuerus, and he has a party, and he says, "Hey Jews, go to the party." The party lasts for 180 days. Imagine going to a party for 180 days. Last night we had a great party. This afternoon we're gonna have a great party, right? Because it's Purim, so you gotta have great parties. So this afternoon, 5 o'clock, you want to come to Young Israel Aish for round two of a great party. Round two of the party, okay? So what happens is this. Ahasuerus invites the Jewish people to a party. They go to the party. They shouldn't have gone to the party because the party was celebrating the fact that the Jewish people would not be redeemed. When the Jewish people, when the temple was destroyed in Jerusalem, we had a tradition from the prophets. They said, well, it'll be destroyed for 70 years. We'll go into exile and then we'll come back. Ahasuerus says, hey, 70 years are up. Jews won't get redeemed. Yay, let's have a party. So there's a party, invites the Jews to the party. The Jews are saying, oh, you know, when in Persia, you got to be like a Persian, right? The rabbi of the day, Mordechai, says, no. Don't go to you don't celebrate your downfall. The Jews say, hey, when in Persia, you got to be like Persians, right? So they go to the party. They have a good time at the party. And God says, I'm going to have to issue a decree of genocide against you. So a little while after that, you know, Ahasuerus, his wife, he executes his wife because she won't appear naked in front of everyone, his friends. And then he wakes up from his drunken stupor and due to a very strange series of events, Esther, a Jewish girl, becomes the next queen. And there's a plot to kill the king. And Mordechai, who's top rabbi and Esther's uncle, discovers the plot, reports the plot, saves the king's life. And meanwhile, back at the ranch, there's a man, Haman, boo. Because anytime you say Haman's name, you go boo, because a bad guy. So Haman, what does he do? He gets promoted to become the viceroy of the world, of the Persian Empire, which encompasses the entire world at the time. And he now, he hates the Jews. Mordechai gets under his skin because Mordechai refuses to bow down to Haman. So Haman convinces the king to issue a decree of genocide against the Jews. Then, due to a very strange series of events, Mordechai rises to become the top dog. Haman and his 10 sons are hanged on the gallows. They're killed and then hanged. And then the Jewish people are saved and we rebuild the temple and it's great. Yay! So it really is that old story, you know, the old joke about Jewish holidays, that, you know, what's a Jewish holiday in one sentence? They tried to kill us. We won. Let's eat. It really is that. It is that. They did try and kill us. We won. Let's eat. And that's exactly what we do. We have a party. So the round two of the party is at 5 p.m. this afternoon at Young Israel Aish. You're all invited. It'd be great to have you. Bring the spirit of your choice, by the way. Yes. Lots of drinking goes on these things. So we have a party. We have parties, right? We have a suda. We read the book of Esther twice. Read it last night. We'll read it again this afternoon. We give money to the poor. Give money to the poor. I suggest giving minimum $20 to the poor. And what we do is I send that money to Jerusalem today. So if you come by Young Israel Aish and you say, hey, listen, Rabbi, I'll get you the money. I will send the money ahead of you to feed poor people in Jerusalem. It's a meal one meal for two different people. And I figure that's a falafel and a Coke, $10 each one. That's not an exorbitant meal, but it's a meal nonetheless. And then also you give gifts to your friends. And that's a very interesting point. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. But we're still on the topic of what is a more important day, Yom Kippur or Purim? Yom Kippur happened in the Torah. Yom Kippur is a Torah holiday. Yom Kippur is a day of atonement. Purim happens 900 years after the Torah was given to the Jewish people on Mount Sinai. The rabbis came up and said, okay, you have to celebrate the salvation of the Jewish people, right? Celebrate it. And what's the deal? Which one's a bigger holiday? Now, if you've been around the Jews, then you'll jump and you'll say, well, Yom Kippur is a bigger holiday. But the mere fact that I asked the question should tip you off that there's some kind of trick here. The fact that I would even ask the question must tell you, obviously, Purim is a bigger holiday, even if you don't know why. But I'll tell you why right now. Because in the Torah, Yom Kippur is called Yom HaKippurim. It's called a day. I'll translate this from the Hebrew. Yom HaKippurim means a day like Purim. It's a day like Purim, which means Purim's the main one, Yom Kippur is the secondary one. Interesting enough, this is written 900 years before Purim even exists, right? But okay, still nonetheless, it's a day like Purim. See, Purim and Yom Kippur, what do you do? You say to God, God, I've sinned. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, God. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I won't do it again. Please forgive me. And then maybe God forgives you. On Purim, you look around, you say, wow, God is running the world. We Jews, we shouldn't have forgotten our way. We should not have lost our way. We should not have gone to that party. We should not have went in Persian, be like the Persians, right? Went in America, be like America, right? Americans, no. Jews stay Jewish all the time. We shouldn't have done it. Another complaint to the Jews, we were scattered all over the place. We were divisive. We were not together. We were not unified. And God does not like that. Parents do not like it when your children do not get along with each other. Parents don't like that. So the Jews were not together. We were not unified. And God says, aha, you're not going to be unified. You're not going to be together. I will bring an anti-Semite from the outside to force you to get together. And that's what happened. Decree of genocide. And then the Jews had to get back together. You forget who you are, I'll bring a goy, a bad, bad non-Jew, and he will come and remind you to be Jewish. You Jews are scattered, you're separate, you're at each other's throats. I will bring a bad, bad man to come against you and to remind you to be Jewish. And that's what you're going to do. 702-257-5396. My name is Rabbi Yitzwein. It's Purim. God loves you very much. It's true. You want to call in. So what do I got to tell you? I got to tell you like this. I want
to know how you see God in your life. Because really, that's the opportunity of Purim. The opportunity of Purim is to see the Almighty in your life. Behind the veil. See, in the book of Esther, God's name is not mentioned at all. Yet, when we read the book, in hindsight, we go, well, obviously God is running the show. Because there's too many things that are happening in the story of the book of Esther that they just don't work. They just don't work. So what you got to do is you got to stop and say, aha, God's running the world, but I usually don't see him. He's hidden. So the opportunity today, the reason this is such a great day, is because if you look at your life, you can say, wow, God really is running. He really is running the show. And that gives people a lot of happy and joy. See, it's way more important to get close to God through celebration and happiness and joyfulness than it is to get to God by saying, oh, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. That's it. And so that's how we do it. Today, we drink, we give gifts to our friends, we take care of everything. That's what we do. We give gifts to our friends. We help others. That's what we do. We give gifts to the poor, and we build a greater sense of Jewish unity. And by doing that, we see the Almighty in our life, and we have a great time. And you get closer to the Almighty, closer to God. Much better to get close to God through rejoicing and helping other people than it is to get close to God by saying, I'm sorry, and repenting. And that's what it is. Yom Kippur, you get close to God by saying you're sorry and repenting. Purim, you get close to God by celebrating. Yay, Purim. We love that. 702-257-5396. My name is Rabbi Yitzwein. And how do you get close to God? How do you see God in your life? That is the question. What are you doing to celebrate Purim? I want to go into, I want to keep the topic, but, you know, there's so many branches. There's so many side themes of Purim. I want to tell you this one. It's really great. So as you know, and you know this because you know, either know this or you know this because you've been listening and I just told you this. One of the things we do on Purim is you send gifts to your friends. Now, the way it's actually written is Mishloach Manot L'Ra'im, that you shall send gifts of food to your neighbor. It does not mean friend. A chaver is a friend. Chaver with a ch. Okay, that is a friend. This is a re'im. If you have to re'echa kamocha, if you love your neighbor as yourself, and this is your neighbor, it's the guy next to you, not a chaver. Chaver is different. Chaver, a friend is someone who's you're connected with. That's what the word chaver means. It's mechubar is when you have a connection. Do people have a connection with each other? Friend is I have a connection. A re'im is someone who I live next to, but I don't have a connection with. So what people do is they give presents, they give gifts to everybody. And so they take two pieces of food and they put in a bag and they go up and they say, Happy Purim. And they give to everyone. That's what they do. They hand it to people and everyone has a great time. It's very nice. Okay. I want to give you a suggestion that will change your life right now. Here it is. Give to whoever you want on Purim. I'm not going to be the guy to say, don't give gifts to your friends. Don't give gifts to the people around. But I want to give you a great suggestion. Find a person that you don't really like. Find a person. Sounds funny. Find a person that you have issues with. Maybe the reason you have issues is because they're just flat out a jerk. Maybe you have issues because you're a jerk. Maybe you have issues because you just don't get along with them. So what do? Is you say, get something nice, you know, nice bottle of single malt scotch, you know, some Reese's peanut butter cups. Okay, I'm hinting, right? And you take this and you put it in a bag and send it to the person today and say Happy Purim. Now, by the way, you know what's going to happen? When they receive this, they're going to love you. They're going to say, oh, it's so nice. And that's going to build a bridge between you and them. Find the person that you're a little on the outs with and build that bridge. And when you give them a gift, you take the higher road. I mean, listen, God always wants us to take the high road, right? There's never a reason to be low. There's never a reason to be, you know, down, right? It's funny. I went to a person last night. I was a little drunk, but just a little, because I never get too much. I always tell, especially the teenagers, because you know Purim, so everyone's drinking. So I always instruct them how to drink. I say, when you're drinking, when you get to the point where you say, the next drink is gonna get me where I want to go, stop. No one should ever get into a drunken stupor. Never. There's never an excuse for that. I don't think there's never an excuse for getting sick when you get drunk. What you want to do is you want to get to the point that you're like a little tipsy so that your inhibitions are gone. And then you can be above your inhibitions and you would say things to people that you would not necessarily say. And you would have good things. And you would say, you'd have insights into life that you would not normally have. That is the purpose of the drinking, of the celebrating. It's not to get drunk. It's not to escape. It's not to like get plastered. It's not to get sick. That's not what it is. It's in order to lift yourself up. So if you keep that in mind, first of all, you're not going to overdrink. You're not going to, you know, you're going to pace yourself and you won't get sick. Okay. So that's where you want to go. All right. So, you know, like sometimes one time I went up to a person when I was a little shaker, a little tipsy. And I said to the person, I said, listen, and as I mentioned before, I shave off my beard every year. So on Purim. So the old guys, they don't like rabbis without beards because the old religious guys, in their mind, rabbis should always have beards. Okay. You don't have to have a beard to be a rabbi. Okay. But it's kind of a bit of a custom. So I turned to a guy and I say to him once, I say, listen, you and me, I respect you very much. I like you, but there's distance between us. And I'm bothered by the distance. I really hope this year, you know, we can close the distance. And he looks at me and he says, grow the beard back. Here I am opening myself up to the guy, right? I'm being very, very genuine. I'm saying, listen, there's distance between us. Let's get close together. And he looks at me and says, you know, just grow the beard back. Okay, what are you going to do? All right. But you know what? If you're a little tipsy, you can handle that. You can handle opening yourself up. And if a person is going to be a jerk back to you, okay, so they're not taking the high road. All right, what are you going to do? All right. But, you know, you can kind of laugh it off and say, right. Okay. So, you know, this is what Purim is. You have to be able to lift yourself up and build bridges with people that you don't have bridges with. And if you're able to do that, you bring a greater sense of unity. And that the Almighty loves that. God loves that. And again, you know, our way of connecting with God is very similar to our way of connecting with others and the wisdom that we get through being a parent. One of the most painful things for every parent is when they have children and the children do not get along with each other. Even if the parent gets along with every child individually, when children fight, it's very, very painful for a parent. So we have to realize that when we fight and we have schism amongst ourselves, for our Father in heaven, it's very painful, so to speak. So if you can say, you know, I don't want to anthropomorphize God too much, you know what that means. To give God human attributes. Right? God is not human. He's not the big guy in the sky. He's not a big old man. Certainly not George Burns or that other guy, Morgan Freeman, right? That's not what God is. God's not like that at all. But still, that's how we understand to relate to God, you know, through the parent-child relationship. So children should always, always, always do their best to get along with each other, with your siblings, for no other reason than it makes your parents happy. Because I would say that every child, on a minimum, owes their parents the respect to at least try and get along with their siblings. It has nothing to do with you. It's not about you. If you understand that life is not about you, you're going to live a great life. As long as you think life is about you, you got problems. Okay, we're going to come back. We'll talk more about this in just a minute. But my name is Rabbi Yitzwein. You're listening to The Rabbi Show. I want to invite you. Call me. Tell me about your Purim. Tell me about how you see God in your world. And don't forget, you know, you want to come by Young Israel Asia, Las Vegas. Today at 5 o'clock, you'll hear the reading, another reading of the Book of Esther in the Hebrew. And then also, we're going to have a party afterwards. And you and I will have a little L'chaim together. And Young Israel Asia, Las Vegas, near the corner of Fort Apache and Sahara. But don't go away. Back more in a moment with more of The Rabbi Show. All right, welcome back to The Rabbi Show. My name is Rabbi Yitzwein. I'm your host here on The Rabbi Show and your rabbi at Young Israel Asia of Las Vegas. And I got great news for you. The Almighty loves you very, very much. Today is Purim. So we really focus on the fact that God loves us in a big way. And I want to invite you, you can call in 702-257-5396. I am very interested to know how you see God in your life. Now, this is a big deal because really this is what Purim is all about. You know, seeing the Almighty in your life when you don't see him. It's about connecting with other people, other Jews, and other people in a way that when you're a little distant from them, so you send them gifts and you build that bridge. At these parties that we have last night, oh my gosh, last night was great. Great party. We do Purim very well at Young Israel Age. I mean, we're a happy crowd. It's a happy place. You know, it's interesting. A friend of mine, he goes, I come to the shul because everyone's so happy, which I love that. I love that. I think it's awesome. And it's the way to be. You know, it's very, very important. Anyway, so Purim's great and people are happy with it's very, very, very important. And the way it works is thus. So when you're connecting with others and you're at this party, and again, come by this afternoon, 5 o'clock, and then we'll read the Megillah, we'll read the Book of Esther, and then we'll have this party afterwards. So everyone's going to be drinking, right? So what do you do when you drink? You do a thing called the L'chaim. Now, L'chaim is a word, it means to life, L'chaim. The reason you know the word is because you've listened to the Black Eyed Peas in their song, I Got a Feeling. And that guy says, L'chaim, Mazel Tov. Okay. So L'chaim means to life, and it is a traditional Jewish toast. But, you know, when we take a drink and we go L'chaim, to life, it's not a toast, so to speak. It's a prayer. So if I'm going to give you a blessing, if I'm going to look at you and I'm going to say, hey, you know, this year you're going to meet the girl of your dreams and you're going to get engaged and your kids are going to be fantastic and your parents are going to be in great health and you're going to make lots of money. When I do all that and I'm giving you a blessing, it's really a prayer. It's really a way that I'm asking God to chime into your life. That's really what it is. And we're doing that in a very big way. You know, I spoke about in shul yesterday. King Solomon writes, Sone metanas yichya, someone who hates gifts lives. Someone who hates receiving gifts lives. A big deal. Now, the reason that is true is because if I'm a person that is constant on the side of being the recipient, then what I will do is I will become entitled. I will feel entitled. And I will always be saying, Leah, you got to give to me. You got to give to me. You got to give to me. And I'll always say, like, listen, you got to give to me. You got to give to me. You got to give to me. Because that's just kind of how it's going to go. If I'm a guy who's receiving gifts at all times, then eventually I turn into a person that expects to give them. And that's no way to live. Because once I depend on others, then I really, 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 then I really now I've become a person that is the walking dead. It really is that. But the other aspect of that is even if I'm thinking to myself, oh, you know what? It's just nice to receive it. No, someone who receives gifts, someone who enjoys receiving gifts, he's not alive. Someone who hates getting gifts, he's the one who lives. The problem with Purim is that we're giving gifts to everybody. Now, when you're giving gifts and you're giving gifts and you're giving gifts to others, that means other people are receiving gifts. So how do you receive gifts? How do you receive the gifts and how do you live? So, you know, in the Garden of Eden, God created man. God created man, put him in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve. He says, the whole world's for you. Garden of Eden, Eden means pleasure. So God created man for pleasure. So he says, okay, you're in the Garden of Eden. You can have from all the fruits you want, except for that one fruit, from that one tree, don't touch. What does Adam do? He eats from that tree. God comes to him and says, why'd you eat from the tree? What does Adam say? The woman you gave me, she gave me the fruit and I ate. And The rabbis of Talmud say that at that moment, Adam sealed his fate. He was going to be kicked out of the Garden of Eden, and instead of living eternally, as he was supposed to, he was never supposed to die. So, what happens? He gets kicked out of the garden, and he dies. So, because he should have owned up to it. But he also, it was the fact that he did not have gratitude. It was the fact that at that point, instead of turning to God and saying, "God, I'm sorry," he said, "God, I don't have gratitude for what you gave me. The greatest gift you've ever given me was my wife. And instead of saying thank you, I threw it back in your face and I blamed my mistake on her." So if he were to have gratitude, then he would have been able to receive the gifts and live. Because he did not have the gratitude, he did not receive the gifts anymore, and he died. And that is the secret to how to receive gifts and live. Have gratitude. So really on Purim, what you got to do is you got to look at all the people that have helped you and look at how people have helped you. Look at how people have been kind to you and show your gratitude. And when you show gratitude, of course, it's a much happier existence. Because if you show gratitude, you're like, "Oh, this is great. I love gratitude. Oh, it's so awesome." If you have gratitude and you show gratitude to others, then what will happen is you will live, you will be much, much, much happier. You will live in a better world, and it will be fantastic. All right, 702-257-5396. My name is Rabbi Yitzwine. I'm the rabbi of Young Israel Aish of Las Vegas. It is Purim. Yay, Purim. Purim's a great day. You know, one of the other things we do on Purim is we give gifts to the poor. So I would suggest that, you know, you send money to the poor, $20. $20, that pays for meals for two people. Two people will get a meal, and that's really, really good. And we send that money to Jerusalem on the day of Purim. It's pretty big. So why do you give to the poor? You know, like, it's a funny question. Why is giving to the poor so important? So, you know, it's very interesting. There's a great saying that a person once said, "I give to the poor I forget the saying. It was a good saying, though. The thing was, no, really, it was such a good saying. It was such a good saying. It just left my mind. The thing is like this, that we have to recognize, you got to recognize that when you give to the poor, not only are you helping someone else, but that's your way of saying thank you to God for helping you. See, you always want to be in the position to be the giver, not the receiver. One who hates gifts lives. You don't want to be the person who's receiving. So as long as you have the ability to do something, you have to, as I say, use it or lose it. You have to be giving to, you have to take advantage of that opportunity. If you're in a position to give, you better give. Because by giving, we show the Almighty that we appreciate being in the position we're in. God forbid you should have to be in a position where you have to receive. So if you are in a position to give, then you should give. But the important thing is not how much you give, so to speak. It's that you give for the right reason. Now, listen, we have rules in terms of how much you got to give, right? Judaism and every other religion says, once you give 10% of their income to charity, which means like this, if you make $1,000, before you touch that $1,000, you should take $100, put it on the side in a different account, and you live on the $900 and take that other $100 and you should give it out to charity. That's what you should do. So don't even take the $1,000 and put it in your bank account. Don't even do that. Put $900 into your bank account, take $100 and give it. 10%. But why do you do it? You do it because you're turning to God and saying, "God, thank you so much for giving to me. And I will take 10% and I'll give it out to others." And if you notice 10%, the magic of 10% is beautiful because it's enough to make an impact on other people's lives. And it's not enough to break you. It's enough to hurt you, so to speak. Not to hurt you, but it'll make a difference in your life. Like, you'll have to scale back just a little bit, not a lot. You'll have to scale back just a little bit, but it at the same time, you can still basically do what you got to do. You know, that's the story. You know, if your car payment is $400 a month, so now you don't buy a car for $400 a month. You buy a car for $360 a month. That's what you do. Well, you know what? That is a different car. That is a different car, but it's not a massively different car. You know, it's a difference between, you know, you getting the Honda with the leather seats or not the leather seats. You getting the one with the sunroof or not the sunroof. I mean, that's what it is. It's not a massively different, but it makes a difference. And it reminds you at all times that you are in the position of giving. And if, as long as you show that you are helping and giving, then the Almighty will put you in the position that you'll be able to give. You got it? That's where you should do it. And if you need help and where to send the money, then I will help you and where to send the money. You go on the Young Israel Aish of websites, Young Israel Aish of Las Vegas. Press and donate. You can do that. And if you have a lot of money to give, but and you don't know where you want to give it, then you should call me and I will help you. Because one of the things that Young Israel Aish does is we manage donor advised funds, which we help people distribute money to the organizations that are in need and the good organizations. So even if you say, I want to help Young Israel Aish, but I don't want to give everything to Young Israel Aish, well, that's okay. We can help you figure out where to give to and what to do and that kind of stuff. All right. The number to call is 702-257-5396. How do you see God in your life? How do you see God in your life? You know, an easy way, the easy answer, and it's not a cheap answer, but it's an easy answer, is when you look at the mountains, you see God in your life. When you look at your children, you see God in your life. But a more complicated way is when you see something, when something happens in your life. Say a person gets sick, and because he got sick, you couldn't go on a trip. And because he didn't go on a trip, you met somebody, and that somebody helped your business in a way you did not expect it. That is God in your life. Imagine you had a relationship with a person, and they did something, and that caused you to do something, and then they did something, and now you don't have a relationship with them anymore. And it was hurtful. Because you love the person, or you enjoy the relationship. So now it's hurtful. You don't have the relationship with them anymore. But because you don't have that relationship, now you're open for the next relationship, and that next relationship is very, very, very beneficial to you. And you're beneficial to that other person. So you might stop and say, I'm really upset that other person was horrible and sabotaged our relationship. But you realize that's God steering you in your life. God wanted to bring you over to this relationship, but it wasn't going to happen as long as you were tied into the other one. So thank God you're not tied into the other one. Because if you were tied in the other one, then you'd have problems. Okay, so you don't want that. 702-257-5396. 702-257-5396. And let me give you an example from the book of Esther. This is a great one. So I mentioned in the story that Mordechai, top rabbi here, he saved the king's life. He saved the king's life. He heard that there was a plot against the king. What did he do? He reported the plot to the government. Reported the plot to Queen Esther. That was recorded, it was investigated, and the evil people were foiled. Right? The plot was foiled. All right. Now Mordechai is feeling good about himself. I'm a loyal subject to the king. Everything's great. How do you think Mordechai felt when one day he opens up the paper and he hears that the king has just ordered a decree of genocide against all the Jews, including him? Mordechai's Jewish. How do you think Mordechai feels about that? He's thinking, what the heck? I saved this guy's life, right? Only later on. Then later on in the story, then it's actually found out. The king recognizes, oh my gosh, it was Mordechai who helped me. And then I got to turn around and everything gets turned upside down to the right way. And Mordechai gets up. He's very happy. Thank God. But you understand, Mordechai, you know, how did Mordechai feel when the one whose life he saved issued a death sentence against him and his whole country, his whole people. So has that ever happened to you? Has it ever happened to you where you helped someone and then they came back and hurt you? And then you found out that the whole process was really a setup to elevate you as a promotion. That's why you got to be very, very careful before you disparage anybody. And very, very careful before you pass judgment on situations. If you want to be a person who thinks and acts like a Jew, you have to be patient. You have to realize that God runs the world. And the fact that God runs the world, don't be so quick to condemn. Don't be so quick to put others down. Be pacified more easily and be slow to anger. Be slow to anger and quick to heal. Because if you really understand that God is running the world, if you have trust in the Almighty, which is what it's all about today, it's all about learning to trust God. God's in control. I'm not in control. Then your past is much better because you won't hold on to the anger that people have hurt you because you know everything happens for a reason. People come into your life for a season, okay? So in other words, you don't have to be so angry about these things. Your present is more calm because again, God's running the world. So even though something bad is going on, I see that something bad's going on. Well, I don't know exactly how it's going to work out, but I don't have to freak out about it so much. And the last thing is the future. You won't worry about it so much. You really will not worry so much about the future. And the reason is because you know that the Almighty has a plan for you. And that's trusting God. Trusting God is the emotional security that a person feels when they know that God runs the world for a positive purpose. Now, it doesn't mean that nothing bad's ever going to happen. No, sometimes bad things happen. But it also means that there's meaning behind the bad things. So, yeah, listen, a decree of genocide is a horrible thing. But that decree of genocide that happened in the book of Esther was there to promote us, to wake the Jews up. To say, oh my gosh, what are we doing? Of course we can't go to the party. Of course we have to work harder to be more godly, to be more Jewish. Yes, anti-Semitism is a terrible, terrible thing. I think there was another bomb threat against the JCC, against the Jewish Community Center in Las Vegas on Friday. Yes, it's a terrible thing. But again, it's there so the Jews will come together. That's what it's there. That's what it's there for. So, you know, you have to realize you have to turn the negative into something that's positive. I spoke a little bit about this. If you go on my Facebook page, go to Yitzwine, Yitzwine, on Facebook. You can see I posted a talk that I gave at UNLV. There was a rally. There was an anti-Semitism rally this past week. The anti-Semitism rally. And I spoke at that. And I posted the video there. You can go to my YouTube channel, too. You go to... Go Yitzwine, Yitzwine, and then click, go on the channel and you'll see, well, I got a great talk about Purim. Or you go to the Young Israel Age website and you can always get the rabbi show. Type in the rabbi show and you always get the archives of this particular, this radio program. All right, 702-257-5396. And it is Purim. Yay, Purim. And I do want to invite you to Young Israel Aish of Las Vegas. If you come at 5 o'clock today, the Megillah reading, we will read the Book of Esther again. And that will be followed by a festive family Purim meal. Festive family Purim meal, which means the teenagers I drink with me. I always love giving the 13, 14-year-olds a little, you know, with me, of course. Having their first L'chaim. That's what I do. Got to teach them how to drink because you don't want them to grow up and not know how to drink. And it's interesting, you know, it's very funny. Like parents don't teach this to their children. Parents really do not teach their children to say please and thank you. Parents really do not teach their children to have gratitude. Parents don't teach their children how to drink properly. It's a bizarre thing, but you got to think, like, if you are older and you have life experience and you have wisdom, you have an obligation to pass that wisdom down, whatever that wisdom is. And it's an amazing thing. You know, like sometimes you see kids and they'll come in and they won't, they'll come in and they'll have dinner at someone's house. They won't clean up after themselves. Totally bizarre. Totally bizarre. But you know, it is a very, very, very important thing that you got to teach people things. You got to teach people the right thing, what to do. All right. So there you go. And I'm trying to, I teach the kids how to drink properly. So anyway, come to the Young Israel Asia Las Vegas today, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock. We'll have the face painter for the kids because everyone's got to come in costume. And if you don't have a costume, we'll make costume for you, right? By having a face painter. And if you come in costume, then we will give you a free coffee bean and tea leaf drink certificate. That's right. If you show up in costume today at Young Israel Asia, 5 o'clock, then I will be handing out Young Israel and Young Israel Aish things. Young Israel Aish coffee bean and tea leaf drink certificates. Isn't that exciting? So anyway, the guy who gives these things to us in order to pass out to other people, his name is Phil Patton. Phil Patton, marvelous human being. He is the president of coffee bean and tea and Jamba Juice. And so I texted him yesterday. I said, hey, listen, you got to come to shul. And if you come to shul in costume, I'll give you a free drink at Coffee Bean. He liked that. It was really good. But I want to invite you to come as well. Also, one of the things is the thing that you have to do, that if you have not done it, so not only do you got to hear the Megillah read, you got to give a gift of food to your friends, right? So again, get two different kinds of food. And give it to someone. And again, I want to suggest that you give it to someone you want to get closer to. So if it's someone you like, then that's good. If it's me, I'm a big fan of single malt scotch and Reese's peanut butter cups. And if it is, and if it's someone who you're a little on the outs of, you're a little on the outs. So what you should do is that's when you really give a nice one. Give someone, build a bridge with somebody who you need to build a bridge with. That's really what you want to do with this. That makes God very, very happy. Also, you want to give gifts to the poor. Later today, I will be sending a whole bunch of money to poor people in Jerusalem. Now, it is a very interesting thing when you give charity to the poor. You should give, obviously, charity starts at home, okay? And that means you give to your family first, if they need it, God forbid. Then you should give charity to people in your hometown. Every Jewish person has two hometowns. They have where they live, in our case, Las Vegas, and you also have Jerusalem. Jerusalem is every Jew's hometown. So that's why I give this money to Jerusalem. There is, however, a beautiful organization, and I should have the guy on the radio show, I'm going to do this, that actually distributes food to poor Jews in the city. And it's very, very good. And I'm not talking about Jewish Family Services, although Jewish Family Services does a nice job too. And actually they do have if you're Jewish and you go to Jewish Family Services, they will give you kosher food. They have that now. But there's also another organization that is fantastic. And they send food every Thursday for Shabbat and to poor Jews. And that's also a really good one. You want to get involved with that, then contact me by going to our website. But the other issue that we want to do is that when you're giving, you are being godly. And the more godly you are, the more you will see God in your life. That's really the key here, folks. Purim is about, you got to be happy. And you're happiest when you're feeling gratitude of all the blessings that God has given you. And you're happiest when you feel, when you see that other people are God's agents for bestowing good upon you. In other words, like this, it's so nice. If someone does something nice for you, you say, wow, thank you so much. I appreciate that. That's good. If someone does something nice for you and you recognize that they are the Almighty's agent, then not only do you show gratitude to them, you have gratitude to God as well. And that is a much higher level of happiness. If you are a person that makes it your life mission to help others, And you, at the end of every day, you can stop and you can say, you know what? Hey, I helped this person. I did this mitzvah. I helped that person. You will be behaving like God. And the more alike you are to the Almighty, the more you will see God's presence in your life. Now, here's the question. The question is, do you wish that when you would give someone a blessing, the blessing would come to fruition? Do you wish that when you would pray something from God, pray to God, God, I really need help with X. God, I need help with my ex. Okay. Right? God, I need help with Y. I there's an issue. Do you wish that God would answer you quickly in the affirmative? That God would take your blessings seriously and bestow blessings to other people just because you wished it? Do you want that? The answer is yes, you do. One of the important rules of spirituality is that the more you are aligned with God's will, the more he will be aligned with your will. You do what God wants, the Almighty will do what you want. So if you want your blessings to have power, if you want your prayers to be listened to, then align yourself better with what the Almighty wants. That's the rule. That's how it works. Not that difficult. Young Israel Aish of Las Vegas, that's the place you want to be. 5 o'clock today. To continue on with your Purim festivities, we are located at 9590 West Sahara, which is close to Sahara and Fort Apache, in between Fort Apache and Grand Canyon, right next to the La Quinta Suite Hotel. And come, we'll be there for a couple of hours and finishing up Purim. My name is Rabbi Yitzwein, and your host on The Rabbi Show. Thanks for listening. And remember always, have a great Purim, and...
God in heaven, you know I love you.
Live joyfully. Have a happy Purim. Purim Smith.